Grace and peace to each of you this morning. We welcome each of you to this service of worship and invite everyone to sign the friendship registers, which you'll find in the center of each aisle. You'll note this week is a special week in the life of this church. We are beginning the celebration of 125 years of our relationship, not only as Waldensian Presbyterians, but also as citizens of Valdese. So you'll note in your bulletin this morning that for Saturday evening, we will be celebrating the Edict of Emancipation this year at the Rock School. It'll be Saturday evening. The meal begins at 5:30 to 6:30, and then after 6:30, the program will begin. The fallow, which we normally have, which is the bonfire, will occur on the football field behind the Rock School immediately after the dinner and the evening program. If you would like, and if you haven't yet done so, you need to, because we've got about 25 tickets left. So if you've not signed up for the meal is $12 for adults, I think children six. Then if you only want to come for the program and not the meal, it will be a catered dinner, a spaghetti supper. Then at 6:30, the program will start, and that will be a $5 charge for that. This will be a program that highlights the 125 years of Valdese, so it will be more of a town event and one which we certainly invite all of you to celebrate with us. And as a result, next Sunday will be a special Sunday. It's what I call the High Holy Sunday of Waldensianism. We have two of those every year, and one in February and one in August. But with that in mind, there will be a unified service here at 10:55. We'll have communion with each other. And the special focus of that service this year will be on who is Claude of Turin. Claude of Turin was an 9th century bishop who was influential, and many of the ideas of Claude of Turin ended up surfacing again 200 years later with Waldo. This Wednesday is the beginning of Lent. And there will be an Ash Wednesday service starting at 6:15 at First Baptist Church. For the last 4 years, we have had, as churches in the Valdese area, we've gotten together to celebrate the beginning of Lent with Ash Wednesday. So there will be the imposition of ashes. It is about a 45-minute service. We start at 6:15, go to about 7, and if choir, if you would like them, might be a minute or two late, but I think we'll get you out there and back if you'd like to come to that as well. So please, if you're interested in starting the season of Lent with an Ash Wednesday service, we do have that opportunity. It will be in the round chapel that's at First Baptist Church. And that is, again, 6:15 on Wednesday. We have several meetings this afternoon, Education, Worship, and Evangelism Committee. And with that, there's also an announcement in the bulletin. The congregation is invited to the wedding of Jeff Jackman and Teresa Pruitt. That will be on Saturday, February 24th, wedding at 6 p.m. at the winery. I want to point out our Waldensian banner that is up before us this morning. It is one that has been at the museum, and we've decided to bring it over and highlight it during this month as a special way to celebrate our identity and to bring the beauty of the rich heritage of the Waldensian faith into our midst. Now let us prepare our hearts for the worship of God. Thank you.
The glory of God shines like a consuming fire.
We have seen the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ.
The voice of God thunders like a mighty storm.
And the God of God speaks, "This is my beloved Son, listen to him."
Take a moment of silent confession. saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance. Christ came into the world to save sinners. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might be dead to sin and alive to all that is good. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel in Jesus Christ. We are all forgiven. Amen.
Am I good now? Okay. All right, so I got my card this week and I was like, did they pick the hardest relatable scripture to children and say, let's put Tamika there every time? No. But I am going to tell you about this story that I heard about this guy who received the power. Now, in your head, I want you guys to be thinking about what this kind of person could be like, okay? So, that's a good guess, but that's not what I'm talking about. So, this person gets this power, and once they get this power, they can do these amazing things, like they can see into the future, and they can think so hard on something that it can actually rain during a drought, or they can see 50 people and pull fire from the sky and destroy those 50 people. What kind of person would I be talking about? Well, I could be talking about God, but I'm actually talking about a person, like, here on earth. Yeah, it sounds like a superhero, doesn't it? And I'm not going to lie, like, a million different superheroes. I was thinking, like, Thor's hammer and Transformative. I was thinking about Transformers and all these wild powers that they were given. So, who I'm actually talking about is Elijah. Elijah was a prophet. And so, Elijah was so connected through his prayers and his dreams that God spoke to him and God gave him the ability to make a difference in the world. So when I think about somebody like that, I think about, you know, I can look out here and see some folks like Kevin, for example, not to put you on the spot, but just coming up here today, what did you guys do? Did you just decide it feels like time to go up to children's sermon? What happened? Did somebody say, all right, kids, put the toys away, it's time to go up? Or were you just like, oh, time to go? Did you follow someone up here?
Yeah.
And you know, maybe like a line leader or a door holder or somebody?
Housewife.
You have all kinds of leaders, right? What do you look for in a leader? Somebody raise your hand. Tell me what you look for in a leader.
Oh, I can't wait to hear what you have to say.
God. That's good.
Silas, what do you look for in a leader?
Jesus.
Jesus?
Oh, you guys. Do you look for somebody that's bossy?
No.
I think you probably do. I think you probably do. Do you look at your parents like leaders? Do you follow them? Sometimes do you see kids on the playground who kids are naturally geared towards going towards them on the playground? And you think, they look quite fun. I want to be with them. Well, Elijah, great and powerful Elijah that prayed to God and was a prophet, he had a friend too. And his name was Elisha. And Elisha was like, look at him. He listens to God, and look what all he can do. I wish that I could just be half of that. So Elisha follows him around. He's like, this is great. I want to be like you. And so you know what? In turn, Elisha becomes a pretty great prophet. And he starts to get to do some really cool things for God too. So what I'm going to encourage you guys to do this week is, I want you to look at people who you think are leaders, and I want you guys to look at yourself like you're a leader. I want you to be a leader, and I want you to lead one person to do something nice. Have you ever heard Pay It Forward?
Yeah.
I want you guys to be inspired to do one nice thing, whether it's that kid on the playground that nobody's playing with, or somebody drops their lunch tray and are embarrassed, and you help them clean it up. I want you guys to do that, okay? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you today and we see leaders all around us, and sometimes we don't know when we're inspired to be the leaders. So allow these children to see the good in this church and in their school and our community, and to see the leaders that they would like to be and be inspired by that for your service. In your name we pray. Amen.
Glory to God.
concerns. I learned yesterday that Joe Ngigu was in the hospital. I think it's pneumonia. I'm not quite sure yet. I'm going to visit him this afternoon. Barbara Donato, also, who had been worshiping a good deal with us up until she had some back problems, now has broken her hip. And so we keep Barbara in our prayers. She's had surgery for that and will be in grace for a few more days. Ryan Freeman's mother, who is Jane Rock's son-in-law. Ryan's mother, Vickery Waldrop, is at Burke Hospice after heart failure and breathing problems, so we keep her in our prayers and Ryan as well. And Mary Barstow's sister, Tina Linz, has a blood clot in the lung, and so and additional heart issues as well as the blood clot. Molly Murray will be having gallbladder surgery tomorrow. This is scheduled, and so we're hoping this will relieve some problems that she's been facing for a couple of years now. Then also, it was reported last week that Alan Felker's wife, Lisa, died on February 3rd, and she was interred in a private ceremony. Good news this morning in that Margaret Blaynott is now home and Pete is with her, and they're going to have some health care providers to be with her. And are there any other pastoral concerns that anybody knows about? John? Joseph Pritchard, who has been at the VA center with rehab for his stroke, actually two strokes, is making good progress and hopes to be home in a couple weeks. Anyone else? Yes. And first name? Tony. Tony Robinette Hall has had debilitating headaches the last several weeks, so we want to keep Tony in our prayers. Anyone else? Yes.
Wanda Hefner had a total right shoulder replacement a week ago this past Friday in Asheville. She is now at at Carolina Rehab and is doing really, really well.
Okay. Wanda Hefner has had a total shoulder replacement and the surgery is going well. She's doing very well and she's in rehab in Asheville. Anyone else?
Yes. Charlie Bean.
Yes. Oh, well, good. Good report on Charlie Mina. He's doing well, although pretty much bound to his home these days at 96. He's making good progress. Anyone else? Let us pray. Lord, and as we begin a new season, a season of Lent, which begins on Wednesday. We are mindful of the high holy moments of your life that you reveal yourself to us, particularly this Sunday as we focus on the transfiguration of Jesus and his blessing that you have given him, the blessing of your love to lead and direct and guide and serve your people. So it is that we live in gratitude for that wondrous gift of love that has been revealed to us in Christ. And in response, Lord, we lift to you those persons who are on our hearts and in our minds, those who are going through very difficult times of physical malady, others with recovering from surgery, still others who anticipate surgery, or are going through chemotherapy, and others who are in declining health and near the end of their lives. We ask, O Lord, that whatever the human condition, that you bring comfort, that you bring peace, not only in their spirits and through your spirit, but also through us, that we may be a source of encouragement for people in cards and phone calls and visits, in ways in which our lives are given over to
person. We ask your blessing to be with us and help direct us, particularly as we now are fully into the celebration of our 125th year and the anniversary that we recognize not only as a church, but also as a town. Direct and guide us, Lord, that we will be that which we've been called to be, a light shining in the darkness, a light that helps to point lives towards you and helps to reveal hope and comfort in the midst of great suffering and turmoil in human life. Help us to be that light, to draw new people into our fold and to help them understand your grace and your love which is available to them. Enable us, Lord, in our mission and outreach as we serve not only those in our midst but also those beyond our doors, whether it be here locally, through our pantry, through our community garden, which again gets started, through the mission that we have and the celebration that we have of a relationship in Guatemala and another in Malawi. We ask you to continue to work through our hearts and through our lives as we serve you faithfully in all we do. Now, Lord, we ask that you hear our prayers and hear our common voice that you have taught us in the prayer that Christ has given us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation,
amidst all the clanging noise, amidst all the voices of this world clamoring for our attention, we redirect our focus this morning, Lord, on your voice, the power of your word that comes down through the generations to speak fresh and new, to inspire us and encourage us that we, like Christ, may be transformed in our lives of service. In Jesus' name, amen. From 2 Kings, starting with first verse of the second chapter. Listen anew for the word of God. Now when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went to Bethel. The company of the prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Please let me inherit a double share of your spirit." He responded, "You have asked a hard thing, yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted to you. If not, it will not." As they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them. And Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, "Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." But when he could no longer see him, he grasped his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Typically on this Sunday, we focus on the transfiguration of Jesus. That is the story of Jesus assembling three of his closest disciples, James, John, and Peter, with him to go up onto the mountaintop. And at the mountaintop, there is an event that happens in which Jesus is now joined not only with his three disciples, but also with Moses and Elijah. Why they knew it was Moses and Elijah, I don't think it was a name tag or anything like that that they had on, but somehow they knew that they were in the midst of the holy, and Moses himself and Elijah is present. Why those two? If you think about the fact that Moses represents all of the law, that Elijah represents as the ultimate prophet, the whole prophecy. So both law and prophet are present with Jesus at this special anointing event. In this anointing event, we see that Jesus is bestowed with a gift. Not only is his raiment transformed into a white raiment, but also we hear the voice of God. "This is my Son, my beloved, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." So the image that we get from this is that the fullness of the law in Moses, the fullness of the prophets in Elijah, is now transferred into the authority of Jesus. And from there on, what we see before is a ministry of healing and teaching and performing miracles of various forms. Now the focus, although there is still some healing and teaching and performing of miracles, the focus shifts. And from the time they go down the mountain, they begin to focus on Jerusalem and on Jesus' ultimate call to be the suffering Messiah. This is a pivotal moment in Jesus' ministry. It is also, if we look back, I have preached so many times on the transformation of Jesus, I thought I'd spare you and me one more round on that particular subject this morning. So I've chosen this passage from the Old Testament, which, by way of being connected here, ties in Elijah and his being transformed and lifted up into heaven. So what's the connecting point? If we think of this ministry of Elijah being the ultimate prophet, and there is a time of great change, very similar to the change that the disciples were becoming aware would happen in Jesus' life, this time of great change was Elijah was going to be lifted up. Not, he wouldn't die. He would be lifted up into heaven, and suddenly Elijah would be on his own. Imagine if you were Elijah, the kind of tension and struggle that that would create in your life. Which is why he wants to follow so closely. It shows us the persistence of Elijah. "I am loyal to you, Elijah, to the end." And that persistence then becomes the means by which he maintains a relationship, even though Elijah says, "You may not want to see this. I'm going to be transformed, lifted up into heaven, and you need to be just stop where you are, and I'm going to go on my own." It's the loyalty of Elijah that we connect with there. Because every time, three different times, he said, "Stop here, I'm going to be crossing the Jordan, I'm going to be going to Gilgal, I'm going..." And each time those events happen, Elijah says, "No, I am staying with you to the very end." Persistence. We as human beings in our own families need persistence. I told the first group this morning that the challenge that our teenagers bring into our lives as they begin to develop and have a sense of their own identity, they've got to push away. But it's awfully hard to parent and to maintain the focus on love when the ways that they push away can be at times offensive. All of us have to struggle with that. But it is the parent's responsibility to remain persistent in the love for the children. Having raised two of my own who were good kids, but I can assure you, they pushed away and were pretty hard at times to parent. My son, in his own way, pushed away, and just a couple of weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, when he was home for Christmas break, he had gone to Montreat to to a young adult worship conference up there. And he came back, and one evening when I was sitting in the den, either reading or watching the television, Sam came in and said, "Devin, I want to talk to you." And turned off the TV. And he said, "I've had an epiphany." And I said, "Well, what is that? What was it?" And he said, "I came to, for the first time in my life, to a respect and understanding of who you are as a minister." I'm telling you, I've waited 4 years to hear that. Not only as a minister, but as a father. I mean, sometimes your kids can push you away. They are very compliant in many respects and loving, but man, can they hurt. And it is the responsibility of the parent to be persistent in love. And that's easier said at times than done, is it not? For those of us who've been parents of teenagers. Because it requires us to keep focused on that which is so important in our lives. Maintaining a relationship when the other wants to push away. Now, it's not just with teenagers. It can happen with spouses. It can happen with parents. Anytime there is a relationship of importance, it can happen within the church. It is the responsibility of us as individuals to be persistent in loving and to hang on to that which binds us together, even when the other person is pushing away. And sometimes without a roadmap that says, "I know this is going to turn out okay," there are a lot of times, and sometimes if it's teenagers, years before you get to the other side of that gulf. Persistence is what we see in Elijah towards Elijah. And his persistence of hanging in there and being present in his life serves as a model for us. But there's a second way in which Elisha serves as a model for us. You remember in there he says, "Before you go, Elijah, before you transform into be with God in heaven, I want your blessing, and I want a double portion of your blessing." Why is that? What's going on in there? If you think about the Hebrew people and the fact that for their firstborn, if they had males, it was always to the firstborn male. If it was a family of females, it would be the firstborn female who would inherit a double portion. Why? Not just because they happen to be the firstborn and somehow better than the second and the third. That's not at all it. With that gift comes responsibility. The firstborn was to carry on the family name and to then take that double inheritance and build it up so that the next generation would be able to inherit it and have enough to inherit. The double blessing for Elisha is a recognition, "Lord, I am going to enter into a ministry of service and I need more than what I've got. I need a double blessing." And you know, the remarkable thing is that Elisha is bold enough to ask for it. We may be bold enough to ask for it the first time or even the second time, but at what point do we give up and say, "Okay, you know, I realize I'll take what I'm given"? If our desire is to serve faithfully and we ask for what we need, serving faithfully as a parent, "I need the wisdom to raise these children. or I need the wisdom to teach, or I need the wisdom to be there for my parent who is with Alzheimer's. If we ask and keep asking, the persistence of Elijah is what we have to go back to, and to be bold enough to say, I am worth receiving this because I am about the ministry that's in my life. But you know as well as I, in every one of our lives, and probably in a lot of Christians that we know, we settle for second best. We don't maintain the persistence in our prayer life to ask God for exactly what we need. Okay, this is my faith. I'll deal with it. I'll put the extra weight on my shoulder and pull my way through to completion. If we do that, we're trying to rely on our own physical strength rather than on a spiritual gift that is promised to us if we keep asking. Elijah dares to ask for the hard thing, as the Bible says, the hard thing. Give me enough so that I can do my ministry, and I want an extra measure of it. Be bold enough in your prayer life to make that kind of prayer. Especially when the issue is not so much serving yourself. Don't pray, I need a double portion so I can get the new car I'm thinking about. No, it is for the ministry that we're called to do. God grant me a double portion of the wisdom, the energy, the imagination, the love, whatever it is. Be bold enough to pray. And keep praying for exactly what you need. Elijah and Elijah are in a time of great change. For Elijah, there is a future ahead without any certainty. I know that Elijah was well blessed when you look at the ways in his life in which he defeated those 450 Baal priests. Clearly God was with him. But Elijah's asking that hard question, will God be with me now? But he's bold enough to pray for it and ask for it because he knows his call to ministry is yet ahead. It's interesting, when you think of double portions, as I was reflecting on this, it came to me that at the baptism of Jesus, we hear the words of God, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased, listen to him. That very same thing happens at the Transfiguration, where the voice of God again says, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased, listen to me. Is that the double portion? God's blessing on the firstborn, the first human, the first Adam, the one who would be the restorer of life for us all. And here we see the blessing of God given to both in two different occasions to Jesus. And then we look at Elisha at the very last of those verses, on verse 12, in which we see that Elijah tears his clothes in grief over the fact that his master is ascending into heaven. Two pieces of cloth, is that a double blessing? Is it a double blessing of grief? Is that the first step in the next direction of his life? That he's got to learn humility through his grief? Perhaps. And oftentimes in our own lives, when we look at things that we think is a curse, and we realize later how God has worked through the hardships of our lives to bring us to a different level, a deeper level of understanding and compassion for other people. Perhaps that's the double blessing for Elijah here. A at the first step of the many great things that he would do later in his ministry would begin with a double portion of grief. God's ways are not our ways. We see that in the person of Christ, who works through suffering and shame and death, so that life and joy and love will pervade. God's ways are not our ways. We are called to be faithful and persistent. We are called to ask for exactly what we need, a full portion, and not settle for half. But the assurance is that God's love will prevail and will be with us in whatever we do. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to stand and let us join together in the affirmation of faith, which is from Paul's letter to the church at Philippi. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Please be seated.
Of the church. We ask your blessing to be with Carolyn as she
takes on this responsibility for the next 3 years. Be with her and guide her in her decision-making. Give her that second portion of your grace and the power of your love and wisdom to guide her as she guides us. These things we ask in confidence in Christ, who is our risen Lord. Amen. Congratulations.
Oh,
direction in your life as you seek to be grace and peace in this world, for it is in need of those gifts and many more. Now, with the confidence of God, we go with faith, hope, and love. And we ask Christ's holy blessing to continue to direct and give us comfort in all we do. In Jesus' name, amen.